the server could be overloaded. It's having trouble serving out all the data. And so you're making these requests, but it's just maybe it's losing the request, or it's something's crashing, or something's not working really, so you're not going to get this data back. And it might be in that case that hitting refresh and causing these requests to be reissued, you get lucky, and it means that you get your page back and somebody else doesn't, and so you buy your Glastonbury tickets and somebody else doesn't. So you've clicked on this URL, so what's going to happen? This kind of breaks up into, in this case, about three different components. So you've got the path in the URL, you've got the name, the domain name, which tells you which website it is, and you've got the protocol, the schema it's called, or the scheme, which is the protocol that's going to be used, in this case, the standard web protocol, HTTP. You've clicked on that, wherever that is. It could be an email, it could be in a web browser, it could be something you've typed in by hand to the URL bar in your browser, whatever it might be. So you've clicked on it, and what's going to happen as a result of that? So what, logically speaking, as at a sort of high level, what has to happen is your computer now needs to make a connection, or your phone or whatever it might be, now needs to make a connection to the server that contains that data and send a request for that data and receive that data back again. So the first thing it's got to do is work out which machine it is it needs to connect to. Because this is the internet, things don't have names, they've got IP addresses. And so it needs to translate the name, which in this case is example.com, into some IP address so it can actually get data to the destination. Because on the routing stuff that we've talked about, all that data, all those packets are being routed through the network based on their destination address. So you've got to put a destination address in the packet. And in this case, you want to find the destination address, the IP address that corresponds to example.com. So you look up the name and you get the IP address. There's a couple of ways this can happen. Kind of the commonest ones are, it might be it's statically configured. There'll be a file on your system called host.txt, or it might be called slightly different things on different systems, but it says, when you see this name, it's this address. More commonly, what will happen is it'll run a protocol called DNS, which stands for Domain Name System. But essentially what happens with that is that your system, before it tries to actually connect to this, will construct a request that basically has a question in it. And the question will be, right, what is example.com? And it constructs that as a request. It may be able to answer that locally. So if you've made a previous connection to example.com recently, it might be that you already have that translation to hand, and so that your computer doesn't need to do anything other than reuse the same answer. But if you've never clicked on that before, then it's going to need to send that request out into the domain name system to try and get a response back to say, what IP address should I connect to? The protocol is quite simple. It's a one shot. Here's the question. What's the answer? But the service that's constructed to operate this is quite complex. So there's lots of hierarchy in it, lots of other servers that will be running, and you'll make a query to one server, which may have to send a query onto another server, which will send onto another server, which eventually will have a response that can get sent back to you. But let's say all that happens. And so you get back the answer that, let's say it's, you know, 10.0.0.1, for the sake of argument. So you now know that to connect to example.com, you have to send packets to the machine with the address 10.0.0.1. So you get back this answer. So then you have to create a connection to it. You've actually got to connect to that machine. So you're going to use a protocol called TCP to do this. And what that does is it sets up a connection to this destination and then allows you to send the request for this path over that connection. So the way TCP works is you're going to have, let's say you've got your client here, the example.com server 10.0.0.1 there. So you're going to send a packet. You're going to reply with a packet. And you're going to reply with a packet. And this is called the three-way handshake. These are called SYN ACK. So synchronize, acknowledge. And at this point here, you've created a connection. So both sides now know that the other side exists and is trying to communicate with them and where they are and how to get there and this kind of stuff. You've now got this situation set up where you've got a connection. So then what happens is you will actually send an HTTP command over this connection that you've created by transmitting a packet to the example.com using this protocol called TCP. And in that packet, let's say it's the old version of HTTP 1.0, there will be a command that will be something like get some path HTTP 1.0. And then it will be new line. The actual HTTP command, the HTTP protocol that's operating here is this get some path HTTP 1.0 new line. And that's the HTTP command that's been sent. And so that gets sent through across this connection to the server, which can then respond with whatever it is that's associated with the data. So that might be a web page, for example. And so that web page might get sent back in a single packet. It might be so big it gets sent in multiple packets. The server interprets this URL, this path, some path, and turns it into data somehow. the Internet of Things stuff coming up, it might be that what actually happens there is that your fridge is turned off or a washing machine gets turned on or something. It could be anything that happens there. And then some data that results from that is sent back to you. So in Web 1.0, that would have been a file would be found in the file system and sent to you. Web 2.0, it's much more, as I said, dynamic databases, construction of assemblage of multiple components to construct the page that then get sent back to you. In fact, it can happen at kind of multiple layers. So this is the case for sending data back responding to this single URL. Commonly what will happen is on a web page, you get a web page into your browser, having clicked on a link, and that web page won't be everything that it requires self-contained. It will contain references to other web pages. So it'll contain references commonly to a CSS style sheet. It'll contain a reference to some JavaScript, maybe several JavaScript libraries. And so what happens as a result of this is that, let's say this data comes back here and it contains other references to some JavaScript file, and it contains a reference to style.com/foo.css, and it'll contain multiple references like that. And then what will have to happen is your web browser will interpret this as it's trying to render this page, it's trying to put the page up in front of you. And it will start having to make connections to each of these sites.
So that first data comes back might actually cause your browser to fire off a lot more of the same thing.
Yeah, and so
let's be honest, most of it will be for adverts.
A lot of it will be for adverts, but this process will have to be gone through for each of those. So there'll have to be a DNS resolution of sumjs.com and star.com and whatever other sites there are. There'll have to be a TCP handshake that will go out to each of those sites. There will then have to be the get/js file.js. There will have to be the get foo.css, http 1.0, http 1.0. And so this simple act of having clicked on that link could cause many name resolutions to happen, could cause many connections to be set up, and it could cause lots of data and commands to be issued in order to allow your browser to pull together everything it needs to put that web page on the screen in front of you.
It doesn't come immediately, so I click it again and again and again, and I click it because it's not working. Does that all happen over and over again?
Potentially, yes. It'll depend on exactly how that's interpreted. So it might be that the browser would decide to ignore some of that because it's already busy. It might be that it's going to reissue the whole thing. It might be that it stops what's been happening early and just throws it all away and starts again. It might be that it lets what's already happening continue in the background in the hope that that's going to finish sooner than the new click that you've just done.
So there might be some intelligence going on there, but generally speaking, it might be quicker to not click again.
Yeah, you need to give it a little bit of time to respond, because if it's a complex page or the internet is busy, there's lots of congestion, or the server is busy, it's overloaded, it can take some time to respond. On the other hand, one of the things that can happen because of the way these protocols work is if this step in particular, the SIN step, this initial connection setup, fails, so that fails down there, that can take a long time for the system to retry that. The other thing is that if this DNS resolution fails, it's not reliable at the protocol level, so DNS doesn't retry for you. The application has to request that to happen, or the operating system usually will request that to happen, because this gets initiated usually by your browser making a function call, a system call to the operating system to say, please could you go and look up this name for me? Then the OS will do some stuff in the background. If that fails, or if that's taking too long, then again, sometimes it might be that clicking it again actually does speed it up, because it forces that to happen sooner.
So there's no direct answer to that then, is what you're telling me?
No, because there's so many different components in this, and you've got the whole internet as well as a whole other bag of components, it's complex. There's lots of stuff happening, it's a complicated system.
We'd like to thank Audible.com for sponsoring this Computerphile video. And if you like books, get over to audible.com/computerphile for the chance to check out an audiobook for free. Today, we'd like to recommend Kim Zetter's Countdown to Zero Day. It's all about Stuxnet, the worm that sabotaged Iran's nuclear effort, and it tells the story of how it was discovered and how it works. So get over to audible.com/computerphile, check out Countdown to Zero Day by Kim Zetter, and thanks once again to audible.com for sponsoring Computerphile for this video.
When I think it was the Pakistan network operator, they tried to inject information into BGP to prevent people connecting to YouTube from within their network. But because of the way they did that, that information propagated, and it caused lots of other networks to also fail to be able to connect to YouTube.